Okay, welcome to the May 2021 horoscope. This is part two, where we take a little bit deeper dive into the asteroids and other things happening this month. So here is your trigger warning. If this is going to upset you, inflame you, or otherwise give you a reason to be upset because you're sensitive to these topics, you're going to want to just bypass the video and save us all a lot of, screaming and gnashing teeth. This video will touch on the following themes or topics, which include sexual assault of children, toxic manhood, lesbianism, as well as feminism and anti-feminism. So if these are big triggers for you, just skip the video. You're not missing anything. All right, so let's get on with the show. Okay, so now we know that we've just left the end of April with a Pluto station retrograde at the same time that a new moon in Scorpio was occurring. So we've got double jeopardy happening with that particular aspect. We also know that that particular Pluto is highly accentuated and will take until the fall, probably October, before it finishes playing out. So what this means for you, my dear astrology fan and thinker, deep thinker, is strategically speaking, you're going to want to step lightly around people and be very careful whose toes you accidentally tread on. So be very mindful of the people you're dealing with and long-term ramifications of things because we are planting seeds or landmines, as the case may be, for the future that will come into bloom, full bloom in the fall. So let's avoid any catastrophic decisions as we possibly can. Remember, short-term gains lead to long-term losses. Now, and I'm just reading my notes off to the side. Jupiter will be heading into its natural sign of rulership, Pisces, in the middle of the month. So around May 14th, Jupiter will slip into Pisces, and that will totally turn the tables on a lot of things. Now, I want you to circle your calendars and watch that date, because around March 14th, the following countries should be prominent in the news. Russia, North Korea, and also Myanmar, although I suspect we may be getting a major announcement out of Myanmar, but not necessarily any meaningful action until June. Either way, it should be a significant announcement if it comes through, and it'll come through around this Jupiter and ingress into Pisces. Now, since Jupiter is in the sign of its natural and ancient rulership, Pisces, it means that it is also co-ruling both Sagittarius and this month, the South Node in Sagittarius. Now, one of the more fascinating things about this planetary movement is both the emphasis on water and large water bodies, oceans, seas, river, wastewater treatment facilities, etc. So we should be revisiting not only water, and how it is managed or its value as a resource much more seriously at this time. But also too, because the 12th house rules waste, garbage, things that you want to make go away, right? End products, like the end of the line products of things, the end of the line for things. So I would also expect wastewater treatment facilities and recycling of water, if that makes any sense. It should come up as a theme starting the middle of the month, moving forward for the next 2.5 years. Now, Jupiter and Pisces also rules, ready? Ancient civilizations and the wisdom or any lessons in self-destructive foolishness that disappeared with them. Now, one of the things we can expect is to feel a shift in our focus globally from preserving the status quo, which is what we've been watching across the globe with everyone, people in positions to benefit from the status quo, no matter how destructive it is to everyone else around them, have been fighting tooth and nail to maintain the status quo, even though it's necessary that we move on and move forward from this. So we can expect the shift to go from that to the living by the golden rule and helping those who can't help themselves, whole Christ energy, if you're Christian, or the spiritual values that are often presented as part of spiritual practices, at their most pure. So that should be where you're seeing the shift going from me and what serves me to literally becoming more of, the spiritual entities we should be. Now, I just want to say that along with this, Jupiter and Pisces can be very tough because Jupiter expands and blows up everything comes in contact with. Pisces rules scapegoats. It also has a lot to do with escapism and addiction, and this is where everybody has this thing about Neptune is, rules drug addicts and, strong Neptune is delusion and every negative thing you can think of because, no other sign ever has these issues. No other planet does that. But with Jupiter and Pisces, there's a couple of things that we can expect. So one, we can definitely see an increase in desire to transcend, right? And to dissolve the hard walls and boundaries between us and other people, between us and the world, right? The urge to merge in a very spiritual sense will be very strong. And in order to merge, we have to dissolve the things that stand between us, right? The walls, the barriers between us. And at its lowest form, the cheap, easy shortcut is to use drugs because that'll dissolve all your boundaries, or other people's. At its highest level, Jupiter and Pisces and this whole dissolution of boundaries so that we can merge on a very real spiritual level with other people, comes from a heart-centered place and is often, ready? It is often displayed through music and art. So, art, poetry, literature, performance, music, all of these things that allow people to transcend their lives in that moment and go to this other place, right? This other very pure, loving place that's above all of this, beyond and above and untouchable by the mess that is the everyday chaos of life. These are the things we're going to see a lot more of. So for the next 2.5 years, artists in particular, artists, writers, performers, people who are involved in the creative arts are going to get a huge boost of support from the cosmos and should do very, very well. Now, when I say art, understand that this also includes craftspeople. So even though craftspeople are not often thought of as artists, like when we think of arts, we typically think of paint and pencil, right? And paintbrush or sculpting, or instruments. Craftspeople, people who are able to create things with skills, actual skills, are just as much artists as the artists we typically think of. The difference in the wording is that when you're using skills to create things with your imagination, or that's born from your imagination, you're not necessarily an artist, but an artisan or an artisan. So, but still an artist nonetheless, and still under this Jupiter Pisces boon and bounty that we're going to get for the next 2.5 years. So, if you're unsure what to do with this energy, or if you have had previous addiction issues, or if you have addiction issues in your family or with your friends, encouraging them to get into creative self-expression, as a way to commune with the divine and to transcend the boundaries between them and these things that are hard to find words for, that will help a lot. They're going to be amazed at what comes through. You'll be amazed at what comes through as well. Okay, now, before the 14th, before Jupiter finally slides into Pisces, it's going to be it's like baseball, right? It's going to be a tough game. So we can expect one last big hoo-ha, the last battle cry. As at the end of this thing before we hit that home run and the game is over. So expect more of this rage against the machine energy, this mass collective unified energy raging against the machine that is dehumanizing all of us. Expect one more giant push of that before we finally turn the corner and we go someplace else and find other ways to do things. This is not to say that these things shouldn't be done or that there are other ways to do it. I mean, they're doing what needs to be done and fits the energy of the moment. But we will see one big final, rodeo, one big final rodeo performance before we finally turn a corner and start moving into new territory. So this will be May 14th. Give yourself 24 to 36 hours on either side of that date. I might even get an extra day or two because it is Jupiter, and Jupiter's got a pretty long reach. And again, circle your calendars, and we're looking at North Korea, Russia, and or Myanmar being very active in the headlines around this time. With Myanmar, again, I think this is going to be a major announcement or decision that we get from them around this time. But meaningful actions for Myanmar might not take place until June, late June. So, but it's if it will resolve whatever's going on over there, that's still progress, and we'll take it. All right. Now, what do we got here? All right, so May 3rd, that's how we're starting the month off. Right after that Pluto station in April, that last week of April, we walk right into this. So circle your calendar May 3rd. This is a very important date. And allow yourself 24 hours in either direction of this day. And depending on, of course, where you are. I'm on Eastern Standard Time in the U.S. Adjust your time zone accordingly. Because this is the time zone I'm working with. So at this time, the Sun will be conjuncting Uranus, both of them squaring Saturn in Aquarius. So now Saturn and Uranus have been in square with each other for a while now, at least a couple of months. And this is a particularly challenging square because Saturn is in Aquarius. Uranus and Taurus squaring that means that Uranus is essentially fighting with family or a parent or a child because Aquarius belongs to Uranus. And now Uranus and its relation, you know, its parent or child, Aquarius, are squaring off and fighting each other. So this creates a tremendous amount of high level, high power tension, like a power line overhead, right? With the Sun coming along and joining Uranus, squaring that Saturn, what we're getting is an amplification of the noise happening here. So whatever the conflict is that these two planets represent in your life, or globally, right? Saturn and Uranus, that Sun coming along on May 3rd is going to ignite that and really blow it up so that there's no mistaking that there's a problem and where the problem is. And ultimately, the theme of this particular square is going to come down to what we have to work with. What do we have to work with here? Okay. And that that examination of resources and protection of what's perceived as limited resources will not just be on a personal level, it's going to be on a community level, a city level, a state level, a national, continental, geographical level, like from the smallest to the biggest groups or identities. These, they all gonna be the same question. What do we have to work with? What do I have? Because I don't have a lot to spare. So the Sun setting off this T-square, or T-square, the Sun setting off this particular square is really going to drive that point home and give us a chance to really get clear about what's happening here. So it will be difficult, but also very good, because the Sun passing across this tension line will also allow us to finally see very clearly where the breakdowns are. And until you can see where the problem is, you can't fix it. So we're being given an opportunity to find the problem so we can fix it. So keep your eye on the prize of that one. Now, at the same time, and now we're getting into the part for this particular video, Sappho, the asteroid Sappho and Saturn will be in exact conjunction from May 1st to May 9th. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with Sappho and the mythology of Sappho, Sappho was a female poetess of such extraordinary talent. Such amazing, extraordinary talent. Her poetry was legendary. So much so that much of her work has been destroyed through time. There's only a few pieces they've ever found left. And she is still lauded as what's considered the 10th muse. And Socrates and Plato, because that's when she was around, is during their time, spoke so highly of her. All of them did. So she's in historical works over and over and over again. And also to remember, like, it's only been, so all you I'm not a feminist people out there, just remember, it's only been until recently that women have been allowed or encouraged to get involved in academics or professions or anything of any kind of identity that didn't involve giving birth to babies and being somebody's helpmeet, footstool to heaven. Okay. It wasn't that long ago in here in the United States, ladies, that you weren't allowed to have a bank account without your husband giving you permission for it, and his name had to be on it, and you were not allowed to have a credit card of your own. It was not that long ago. Believe it was the 70s, no, maybe even late 70s, early 80s when women were finally allowed to have their own credit cards. Welcome to America. So Sappho, in the time of Plato and Socrates, was doing the unheard of. So not only was she an extraordinary poetic talent, but she was an intellectual of the highest order, so much so that Plato and Socrates, two of the greatest thinkers we know, like held high praise for her. That's something. You always look at the stuff in context, right? Now, so the asteroid Sappho has a lot to do with literature and writing and poetry, and also love in its highest sense. And this is where it gets a little weird. We're going to talk about this in a second. So stay with me because this gets a little twisty turny, but it's important. Now, because Sappho wrote much of her poetry about her love of womanhood, you know, her love of being a woman, her love of women, you know, her love of women's communities, like all things feminine and woman, she lauded and celebrated with her poetry. She had wonderful things to say about the experience of being a woman, being in the community of women, you know, and the extraordinary things that women bring to life, right? As a result of that, the historians, the male historians, because up until recently there were only male historians, all of them through time have speculated that she was a lesbian because her poetry is only about women. Like, what kind of woman would only write poetry about women? You know, there are men here like me. So, and this just kind of took off and went on with it, with what it did, because we know so little about her, right? And it's so easy to assume, you know, salacious things, especially about people who go against convention, which Sappho clearly did. Now, Sappho lived on the island of Lesbos. And his, back in time, this is where the term lesbian came from, because it intimates or suggests that, you know, to be a lesbian or of Lesbos is to be like Sappho and to be so woman-centric that clearly you must be a female homosexual because, well, how could you have anything around which your entire life and joy circled if it wasn't a man, unless you're a lesbian? So here's the thing, right? So Sappho may or may not have been a lesbian. She may have been bisexual for all we know. We don't know. I think she may actually have had a husband at some point. But these things are secondary to the fact that she had a she one, she was an intellectual. Two, she was doing the things that women weren't encouraged to do, you know, which was have a life and, you know, express her and nurture her intellect, you know, and be more than a walking baby carriage. To have more passion in her life than keeping her cheating husband at home, like all the goddesses in mythology seem to have been, you know, born with a cross to bear of doing, right? So she's doing all these things, and this, of course, you know, raises, you know, they need to give an explanation that makes her something not desirable for women to want to be. All right, so in any event, this is why Sappho is associated with lesbian love for exactly these reasons. And understand that at the same time, there's very little evidence otherwise to support the male historian, because remember, all historians were men until very recently. The male historian's interpretation of any female's ability to have love that's anything but limited to erotic or parental love. Because for men, you know, these things tend to be one of two things. You know, love is either erotic love or it's parental, like parent-child love, right? Like there is no other love. And well, you know, except like fraternal bro love, I suppose. Now, the reason I say that, so anyway, it's through that lens that they see this. So of course, when they see this woman, they can only imagine that her love for women can only be erotic or parental. So she clearly didn't give birth to these people, and they are not all her mothers. So the only thing left in her mind has to be erotic love. That's why she was so obsessed with women, you know, and the joys of womanhood and women's communities. So the thing I want you guys to keep in mind, right, and older women will appreciate this, right, and younger women too, but I think older women, we've lived long enough that we've seen this, especially if you've traveled outside of the US, where it's the cultures are different, so we're not, other people are not as hypersexual as we are, right? Or their culture is not as hypersexual as ours is, so it's a different experience. If you've had a chance to travel outside of the US, then you get it. Like you'll understand what's happening here. So with that said, it is important to note that women do not experience affection and sexual arousal as the same thing. Women can have and experience and feel affection for other people without ever once becoming sexually aroused. These are not the same thing. And a woman can be sexually aroused that having a without needing, physical affection, as a precursor for it. Trust me. So if a woman gives you a hug, it doesn't mean that she wants to sleep with you. It's because she just wants to give you a hug. And she's not likely to get sexually aroused by giving you a hug. And that's the difference between the estrogen dominant and the testosterone dominant crowd. So, with that said, also, the ability to express or the need for physically intimate affection is primarily for women a platonic, or which means non-sexual, expression in females. And as a result, sexual arousal and physical affection are not automatically merged together when women experience or express it. So, the sexualization of affection or intimate contact, when perceived or experienced, seems to be more consistent from the adult male population. So, men tend to see and interpret physical affection or physical intimacy, being physically close to someone, as a precursor to erotic experience or as something that is arousal inducing. Not the same thing for women. And also, before I finish this thought, remember too that this is not a research observation, but a personal observation by me that's often shared by females of all ages across the globe. Now, with that said, with all of this, exceptions will occur naturally. I don't care about the exceptions. We all know there's an exception. We're not having that conversation. In this conversation, I'm saying all of this because women need physical contact as much as men, where men tend to have more aggressive or jocular sort of interactions with each other, just physical contact, the horsing around kind of thing that men do. Women are not typically as rough and tumble. Like women don't tackle each other, in the hall as a sign of affection, right? So women have just as much need for physical affection and contact and will often express it to each other without ever having any desire or interest in sex or erotic intimacy with the other woman. Now, obviously, times are changing and people are more open to different stuff, but at the end of the day, like this is a very real thing. There's a thing called lesbian bed death for a reason. All right, and a lot of it has to do with the lack of testosterone in a relationship. Testosterone and Mars in your chart have to do with your sex drive. Venus and estrogen in your chart has everything to do with how you express affection and platonic, non-sexual love or attraction to other people. Right, so why are we talking about this? Well, I'm bringing all this up because remember, Sappho's conjunct Saturn this week, or this particular week from May 1st to May 9th, and Saturn cools the erotic fires and chills the affections. So, together with the asteroid Sappho, this is going to bring platonic versus erotic love to the forefront of conversations and our consciousness this week. And this is where it's going to get a little deep and a little icky, right? Now, because of that, the misuse of platonic affection for sexual purposes, right? So, ooh, I want to give you a hug, baby. And you're not trying to give anybody a hug. You're literally trying to feel them up. Like this is the misuse of physical affection for other purposes, specifically sexual. All right. So the misuse of platonic affection for sexual purposes will receive heavy penalties this month with no forgiveness. All right. This is especially true when discussing matters of sexually predatory behavior towards children and youth, since displays of platonic or non-sexual affection are often used as a disguise to confuse the victim while gaining physically intimate access so that the perpetrator can commit sexual assault. That's the reason most sexual assaults of children are committed by people the child knows in the home or by friends of the family. It's not strangers on the street in cars in white vans marked free candy. It's not boogeymen jumping up from behind the bushes. 90% of the time or better, sexual assaults on children occur by people that the children know. And the vehicle and method for getting physically close to these children in inappropriate ways always begins with a disguise of platonic affection. So this is something that may be coming up as a big theme at this time when we have these conversations. So more awareness of what the word grooming means and who the actual predators are when it talks about child sexual abuse, right? And how they're getting access. And at the end of the day, it's children, it is literally people that children know. It's not strangers on the street abducting your kids out of parking lots. It's literally the people that the kid knows, right there in your own house or your own family or at school. Like, it's literally people who have access and trust of the kids, and that's not strangers. Okay. All right. So now, Saturn, the planet Saturn, also rules responsibilities, obligations, and social contracts. We associate Saturn with wisdom because our elders have lived long enough, we hope, to have seen the damage and the destruction that comes from breaking social contracts or not upholding responsibilities and obligations to the people around us. Ultimately, we like to think that people, the older, our elders, have lived long enough to see the fallout from bad decisions like this and bad actions and bad faith actors who do these things to other people and how people end up hurt for years, lifetimes, as a result of these things, because they're the story keepers. They're the ones who tell us those stories, so we have that to refer to when we're trying to make sense of something, put something in context, right? Now, the wise ones remember those times and become teachers to help us avoid repeating those things or those patterns, so all of us together as a group, we can all evolve and move forward. Unfortunately, the other ones just get older and not smarter, and they're sharing nothing with anybody except these fantasies that they have about what the past was like. Oh, back in the day, in my time, oh, so much better back then. Sorry. And the only other thing that they're offering is cynicism about what the future holds. Oh, you damn kids. So there's two types of elders. They're the ones who've seen things, who've experienced things, who've learned things, who've watched things, who get it, right? And want to make sure that these things don't happen again. So they try to warn us through the stories and experiences of things that they've seen or heard about. When I was a kid, there was this, kid lived down the street, blah, 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 blah. And apparently this thing was happening and, he's never been right since, yada, yada, yada. That's a different kind of elder, right? Who's sharing these experiences because we need to know these have real consequences, right? Compared to the elder who's just a potato head, right? Who lives in like these sentimental memories about what the past they want to believe. He used to be like, oh, it was so much better back in my day. Oh. And how awful the future is going to be. Oh, yeah, you kids. Whatever. There are literally two very distinct types of elders. So when you're listening to the older ones, you always want to listen to the one who's going to give you something that will help you move life forward, right? And it give you an example of why things shouldn't get done because this is what happens when you break social contracts. All right. So with that said, my friends, wisdom is a precious gift. It's not a right. It's not a de facto setting. It doesn't automatically happen just because you got old. Sometimes you just be an old fool. Wisdom is a precious gift. And with that said, Saturn and Sappho conjunct during this week will call upon the wisdom of grandmothers and women's communities to help heal what has been broken. So if you'd like some more information about child sexual abuse or Sappho, or lesbians, I'm going to put the link down in the description box. All right. Okay. So while that's happening, told you this video is a little heavy. All right, while that's happening, Mercury and Venus will be following each other into Gemini to join the North Node in Gemini later. So we can expect the first few weeks of May to be very active and filled with lots of nervous energy and communication overload and hustle bustle and people interacting with each other in busy places and almost feeling like life before the pandemic began. So, emails, phone calls, Zoom calls, internet forums, dating apps, and every other manner of communication, socializing, and interacting with other human beings will be wiring and firing across the globe at an almost frenetic fireworks pace. So, we will all be busy chit chat, chit chat, chit chat, chit chat, chattering away with each other and everyone we can possibly bend an ear for, right? Okay, now, Sirius enters Taurus on May 9th. And she will be settling in for a comfortable visit, and this is going to be a great place for Sirius. Sirius likes being in Taurus. This asteroid goddess rules home, hearth, and grain, and resource management. These things will become a major topic and focus for all of us, even at our most personal levels. So, for those of you who are crafty, canning, preserving, curing, and other forms of old-fashioned food preservation techniques will get a huge boost of support from this asteroid while she's visiting in Taurus, which will be a while. So, if you're willing to teach your local community how to do this, you're going to get more support and more momentum than you thought possible for it, and earn more than a few gold stars of karmic good luck for the future in the process. So if you're one of those homey homestead, what is it, wagon on the prairie people, like this is the time to dust off those skills and share, help other people learn how to do it too. Okay, so also with Sirius, motherhood, reproduction, and children will also become key battlegrounds that must be addressed immediately now, not later. Remember, Sirius is the goddess whose daughter was abducted by the Lord of the Underworld, and the god refused to intervene. Okay, so remember, Sirius was the goddess whose daughter had been abducted by the Lord of the Underworld. And when Sirius begged, pleaded, beseeched for him to give back her daughter, he refused. Okay, so she went to the gods and said, "You have to help me get my daughter back. He kidnapped my daughter." And of course, the gods were like, "Yeah, well, see, because he's kind of a god too, and we really don't want to, we have to handle these things diplomatically, and we really want to get involved, and blah 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 blah. Excuse, excuse, excuse." So Sirius said, "Oh, is that the way it's going to be? Well, fine then." So in her grief and her fury, she said, "All right. As long as I don't have my daughter, as long as my daughter is not here with me right now, nothing will grow. Nothing. There will be no grain. There will be no grass. There will be nothing." And everything stopped growing. And then insects started dying, or starving to death, going hungry. They had nothing to eat. And animals started dying because they had nothing to eat. And of course, now the mankind was starting to suffer, and they were going to starve to death because there was nothing to eat. Then the gods got worried because, wait a minute, if she kills off the people, if they all starve to death, who's going to believe in us? So then suddenly they felt motivated to help. So realizing that Sirius was not playing around, and this was bad news for everybody, not just her. Like now, this was bad news for everybody. They sent somebody down to the underworld to try and negotiate with the Lord of the Underworld to bring Sirius's daughter Persephone back, or it's Demeter and Persephone, Sirius and I don't remember the other name, but Greek and Roman mythology, same characters, slightly different names. Anyway, so so they went down to negotiate with the Lord of the Underworld, and he's like, "Well, I'm gonna let you have her back, but listen, dude, while she was down here, she did have six pomegranate seeds, so I'm just saying, like, social contracts." So they returned Persephone back to her mother Ceres, and explained that because she had eaten six pomegranate seeds in the underworld, that she had to go back a month for every seed she'd eaten. So Ceres said, okay, fine. Because clearly, if the gods had done their job when she had asked them the first time, there wouldn't have been enough time for her daughter to eat six pomegranate seeds. She said, for the 6 months that my daughter is in the underworld, nothing will grow. Nothing will grow. And I will not let anything grow until she returns to me. And while she's here, then things will grow. Hence, our cyclic planting seasons, right? So that is the story of Ceres. And Ceres, the asteroid, has a lot to do with motherhood, right? The ferocity and protectiveness of motherhood, but also issues specifically related to motherhood. So now that Ceres has entered Taurus, which is very natural territory for her, we can expect to see also at this time kicking up matters related to motherhood, reproduction, food production, farming, and land management become high priorities and supported issues that need to be addressed compassionately and wisely. And everybody's going to agree on those points. Because even a compromise at this point will carry the reminder of what can be lost permanently if the agreements are not honored. Because remember, Ceres did not return everything back to normal when she got her daughter back. She said, oh, no. If we're going to uphold social contracts and my daughter's got to go back there for 6 months every year, then those 6 months a year, nothing grows until I get her back. So, with that said, remember, short-term thinking leads to long-term losses. So, Ceres entering Taurus is definitely going to remind us of that when it comes to our resources and how we manage them. All right, now put on your dancing shoes, Martha. We're gonna have a spring celebration. The new moon in Taurus on May 11th, 2021, is optimistic, and we will finally be on an upswing, and we'll be so happy. We may be kissing strangers on the street in a moment of sheer joy. But don't, please don't. And if you do, make sure you get consent. And please keep your mask on over your nose. Right. So now, before I get into this, I want you guys to keep in mind that this whole month is going to carries what's called a bull pattern, astrologically or astronomically. And Mars and Pluto are the outer rims, or the points of the horn. Okay. So this means that our activities, personally and as groups, will be feeling more focused and sharp in thinking and action. So even if you don't know what's happening, you're going to feel it. Like you're going to feel like you're kind of coming down a cattle chute. Like it's all very focused and narrow and intense and like determined. So this month we'll have the building blocks. This month has the building blocks of massive success built into it. Organization, discipline, vision, and unwavering faith in the face of what appears to be impossible challenges will bring about lucky breaks and knowledge from other sources that you need to make your dreams come true. The hardest work you've done on working towards your goal may be during this month, and if you stay the course, it will be worth it and reward you with gains far beyond what your modest hopes would allow. So stay the course, fight through the fear. And remember that this month is a test. It is a test, and you won't get a second chance to pass it. So focus. All right. Asteroids, Juno and Pallas, squaring off like a boxing match. They're in tight opposition from May 12th to May 25th. Now, this is interesting, because Juno and Pallas were both warrior goddesses who held their own against any and all male challengers. And if you read their mythology, it's right there. Like these were two badass women. So, Juno was Zeus's wife. She was the queen of all the gods. And she was Zeus's wife, you know, Zeus, who slept with everything under the sun, like literally couldn't keep his god like wang in his pants to save his life. And even with that, she still wouldn't abandon him in spite of all those infidelities. But The thing to remember is that while this is happening, so not only is Zeus doing what Zeus does, which is pretty much sleeping with everything in sight that tickles his fancy, while this is happening and she's refusing to leave him or abandon him, she's also not his doormat or his subordinate. So if you read these mythological stories about Zeus and Hera or Juno, and I don't know what the other word for Zeus is, right? One of the things that you're going to see is that with all of this going on, she was not a doormat. She was not his subordinate by any stretch of the imagination. So there's something to be said about that, and the reasons that some women stay married to men who clearly have difficulty staying home where they're supposed to be. That's a whole other conversation too. All right, so that's Juno. Now Pallas Athene is the daughter of Zeus, I believe it was Zeus, one of the gods, and she literally was born from his forehead. This god swallowed all of his children before they were born, because he had heard a prophecy that one of his children would overtake his throne. And you know, we can't have that, can we? So naturally, of course, he eats all his children. But Pallas Athene is such a badass. She's like, yeah, I don't think so, daddy, right? So she gave birth to herself by literally cracking his skull open from the inside out and walking out and saying, hello, baby, I'm here. Pallas Athene is such a badass goddess, that she was worshipped as a goddess and the patroness of war and warriors. Soldiers went into battle and paid homage to Pallas Athene, the goddess, before they went, petitioning her for her protection during battle. That's badass. Pallas Athene is complex, independent, and multifaceted. And with all of that, this Pallas Athene, she also has an affinity with handicrafts, the law, and hunting. So she was quite the sportswoman and quite the DIY girl herself. Both of these goddesses, it's important to know that they are both self-sufficient and comfortable with power and the use of it. And these are the two squaring off in opposition with each other between May 12th and 25th, and really bringing to the table, like right there where you can't miss it, all the issues that they both join together for and represent. So with that said, we might expect menstruation and uterus or in utero products to become a focal point with the opposition this week. And when I say in utero products, I mean things like stem cells, right? So the use of stem cells may be dragged into court at this time for argument again, or the pink tax on menstruation products, or the illegal hysterectomies performed on women of childbearing age in ICE facilities a couple years ago under the Trump administration may resurface for review at this time. Women near or past menopausal years, so listen, ladies, if you're 40 or over, this is for you, will rediscover their strength and their wisdom if they're comfortable acting as champions and advocates for the younger people around them. So if you're willing to step up to bat and go to bat for the younger ones, because remember, if you're lucky, as you got older, you carried the stories and experiences of history with you. So that's where your wisdom is being drawn from. And if you're willing to share that and act as an advocate and champion for younger people, you will get much, much more than I can possibly describe here. It's a necessary, beautiful thing that you'll be doing, and you will be rewarded for it, because it is your destiny. All right. Now, on a personal note, we are dealing with this aspect in combination with a month-long T-square with Eros, Chiron, and Psyche. Ugh. And Chiron in Aries is the leg of this T-square. All is happening while following that Sappho Saturn conjunction that cools the romantic and erotic affections earlier that week. All right, so this combination of planets, asteroids, and aspects, all of them that we just discussed, will push, you should know this, will push brittle relationships to their breaking point. And it will force to the surface conversations about platonic love versus erotic love versus sex as a weapon and toxic manhood. Now, note that conversations that are rooted in compassion and have a genuine desire to find a solution through understanding, not shaming and blaming, will result. Will result in deeper wounding and larger problems. So, if you're going to have these conversations, you have to come from a heart-centered place with a genuine desire to understand and a genuine commitment to being kind and compassionate, especially about things that don't make sense to you or that you don't understand. Because if you don't, you will cause much deeper wounding than already exists. One of the things I just wanted to point out here, and then I'll get into a little thing about feminism. One of the things I want to point out here is that Chiron and Aries has really brought to the surface issues of toxic manhood and wounded masculinity. There are very, very good male speakers who speak extensively on this topic about the wounding of men and toxic manhood, and all of the things that we have done as a society, right, as a whole, all of us together, in our misguided ways. That have crippled our men, emotionally and psychologically. And all of this has resulted in very, very deep, deep, rigid wounds, and very rigid psychology, and this hyper masculine, almost cartoonish, display of, what manhood is with that, not even knowing what it means to be human anymore, right? So there's a lot lost in this posturing that we've been witnessing. When Chiron moved into Aries, this really came into big, big display because it became very much about power and manhood and masculine power. And the people with the most power, who were the most masculine, were the ones most angry and frightened about changes that were happening, feeling like everybody was out to get them, right? We're still dealing with this. And this month, sorry, here we go with the itching. This month with Eros, Chiron, and Psyche all together, right? So what we have is Eros and Psyche are opposite of each other, and Chiron is the leg of that T square. So Eros and Psyche have a lot to do with romantic love, right? And so this has a lot to do with male sexual expression. So we may be having conversations this month, all month long, about male sexuality. What is male sexuality? What is healthy male sexuality, right? And this goes beyond porn. Like, let's be serious here. So this is not about porn or about, men as all men are rapists. Like, it's not about that. This has a lot to do with the hyper masculization of men and this objectification that we do of men, where men become these walking libidos, these animals that have, these desires that need to be addressed because that's just the way they are. And they have no other, if they don't behave in that way, where everything's an opportunity for sex and everything they think about is sex, 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 right? It's all electric penis. If they don't behave that way, then there's something wrong with them, right? They're less of a man. They're defective somehow. Not that they're human or normal or, that these things are just as cyclical for them as arousal patterns are cyclical for women. We always create our own monsters in society, but we've literally created this caricature of manhood who's basically a fighting, robot with no feelings, which is crazy. That's not even normal or attractive, but this is what we've done. So the problem is we've given them no other alternatives to be anything but that. And if they are, somehow they're faulty. So Chiron and Aries as part of this Eros Psyche T square is really driving home and really putting a fine point on where these things come together. So male sexuality and the expression of it, and where the deepest wounds are, right? In terms of society's expectations of men, how are we objectifying men and expecting them to be these cartoon characters, are basically just giant walking genitals with, an AR-15 strapped to it, right? These are the things that are going to come up as part of conversations, or focus, right? Focus. This month. And it may show up in other ways, but ultimately, if you scratch the surface a little bit more, like wipe off some of the mud, right, that's what you're going to see. And all of this is an attempt to try and, we would hope, heal. So with that said, when these conversations come up, especially for a woman right now, it's very important, dear God, it's very important that you don't do a lot of this, right? We often, as women, we often feel that we are victimized more, objectified more. We've really got a heavy cross to bear in this lifetime if you were born a woman, you know. And I get it. Obviously, I'm a woman. I've been living as a woman my entire life. We all know, right? Especially if you're a woman who's not in the dominant power culture, which these days is white, right? So if you're not a white woman, your experience of the world is very, very different. So, and the further away from white that you get in complexion, the more of the crap you're dealing with because you become less and less important to other people. So it's easier for other people to project all their greasy, undesirable thoughts and feelings and behaviors on you because you don't matter in their mind, right? I get it. I totally get it. But even with that, because we've been given this crossbar, because we have been given the task of being better than that. We have been given the task of being lighthouses on the cliffs to keep the ships from running into the reefs. We have been given this task and this choice to try and rise above this and to guide, you know, and shepherd other people. You know, it's important for us to do our best to remember that we may have been victimized, but we are not victims. We are survivors. And survivors lead and ch make change from places of strength, not weakness. So that is weakness, because weakness can't afford to move their position. They've only got a little bit of ground to stand on as is, and they can't afford to give that up. We're not weak. We're very strong. We may have been victims. We may have been victimized. But we are not victims now, we are survivors. And we are, with that, we have to embrace that and make that work for us. And this also means that making that work for us is when we're dealing with men and male sexual issues and not letting those issues push our buttons and shut down communication so that now neither one of us can do any healing. Now, okay, so with that said, I just want to finish up this section with this. Now, with this Eros, Chiron, Psyche, T-square, the other thing I want to say, and I mean this, for any female of any age who subscribes to the radical feminist position, echoing the sentiments of Andrea Dworkin feminism, you are part of the problem, and you should maybe stop right now and address the limitations of your experiences and the lack of understanding that comes with it. And more importantly, if you identify as a feminist, or even more important, if you identify as not a feminist, and you know who you are, ladies, oh, I'm not a feminist. I'm not a feminist. In either of these cases, if you don't know who Andrea Dworkin is, or what her philosophy is, then you are neither a feminist nor a not feminist. You're nothing. You're just ignorant. And you really want to do more self-education before you adopt an identity or slap a label on yourself. I'm not a feminist. Feminist. Based on something you don't actually know anything about or the history of. Okay? Andrea Dworkin. I want you to look that up. It's very important. Because not all feminists are radical feminists. Not all feminists are Andrea Dworkin feminists. Okay? And not all, I'm not a feminist, are actually not feminist. If you're enjoying all the rights and privileges of modern womanhood and you haven't given those up, you're a feminist. You're enjoying all the things that feminism has given you through time. So don't be a hypocrite, sister. Either give up all those privileges or stop calling yourself a not feminist. And remember, radical feminist and feminist, not the same thing. Andrea Dworkin is like the dividing line between feminist and crazy. All right. So, not all not feminists are actually not feminists in practice, and labels mean nothing. Action means everything. So educate yourself before you start slapping sticky labels of identity upon yourself. All right. All right, so we're going to finish this up here. Now, are you ready for the biggest game changer of the month? Are you really ready? The full moon on May 26, 2021 is a lunar eclipse, and it will occur at 5 Sagittarius, and it will square its natural ruler, Jupiter. Hey now. Okay, so who's that planet threatening a good time here? This lunar eclipse promises to be super special and bring with it something we've all been missing for a long time now. And that is, you ready? Some room to move, some, what is it, a reason to laugh, and simple joys that we can share with others. So don't be alarmed by the Mercury-Venus conjunction squaring Neptune happening at the same time. And it's there. On the surface, that conjunction may appear, or that square, Mercury-Venus conjunction squaring Neptune, on the surface, that may appear to be mayhem and confusion everywhere. But there is magic hidden in those planetary aspects at this time. Because Mercury will be conjunct the fixed star Alhica, the horn of the bull, and Venus will be conjunct the fixed star Bellatrix, the female warrior. Now, these are typically classified as unfortunate fixed stars because of their natural, martial, violent, take no crap from anyone dispositions. But remember, context is everything. A bull in a meadow of flowers is a beautiful sight to behold. A bull in a china shop, not so much. So context is everything here, right? The magic in this trio of planets and the fixed stars, Mercury, Venus, Neptune, involving Alheca and Bellatrix, spells out, ready, the end of bullshit. Bullshit. For situations that have been built on getting away with nonsense by trying to wrap a pile of bull dung up in a ribbon and convince folks it's a gift of extraordinary generosity. Those days are now over. Over. When you mess with the bulls, you're going to get the horns. That is going to be the theme for this lunar eclipse, and this is the end of the line for some folks. So, for those of you who've been living by the golden rules and acting from a place of compassion and spiritual generosity and trying to love thy neighbor, even if you'd rather stuff them in a circus cannon and shoot them to the moon, you darling, sweet cheeked, lovely, angelic human being who restores my faith in humanity just by existing, you are about to get a giant thank you card from the universe, and it's going to be for all your hard work at trying to be a decent person at this time. So, rejoice, do-gooders. If you've been waiting to have the last laugh instead of being the punchline for someone else's jokes, that day is finally here. Now, does everyone benefit from this eclipse? Sadly, no. Some folks may only see an increase in confusion, aggravation, and inconvenience coming from left, right, and center. Others will be horrified to realize that they are getting what other people would call their just desserts. And still others will still get an unhappy ending in spite of doing everything right and deserving happy ending. For those of you who fall in this final group, I want you to remember this story and hold it dear to your heart this month because it will especially apply to you. Things aren't always what they seem, author unknown. Two traveling angels stopped to spend the night in the home of a wealthy family. The family was rude and refused to let the angels stay in the mansion's guest room. Instead, the angels were given a small space in the cold basement. As they made their bed on the hard floor, the older angel saw a hole in the wall and repaired it. When the younger angel asked why, the older angel replied, "Things aren't always what they seem." The next night, the angels came to rest at the house of a very poor but very hospitable farmer and his wife. After sharing what little food the couple had, they let the angels sleep in their bed where they could get a good night's rest. When the sun came up the next morning, the angels found the farmer and his wife in tears. Their only cow, whose milk had been their sole income, lay dead in the field. The younger angel was infuriated and asked the older angel, "How could you let this happen? The first man had everything and yet you helped him?" The second family had little but was willing to share everything, and you let the cow die. Things aren't always what they seem, the older angel replied. When we stayed in the basement of the mansion, I noticed there was gold stored in the hole in that wall. Since the owner was so obsessed with greed and unwilling to share his good fortune, I sealed the wall so he wouldn't find it. Then, last night, as we slept in the farmer's bed, the angel of death came for his wife. I gave him the cow instead. Things aren't always what they seem. And that, my friends, is May. Now, we will be doing a special goddess video on Medusa and her connection to Algol, the fixed star, in a separate video, so look for that. And I hope you enjoyed this video, and we'll see you guys soon. And like, subscribe, share.